As Major League Baseball embarks on another season of colorful personalities and melodramatic stories, it's easy to forget that the national pastime was once a dramatic chapter.
America, and we have three people who played a significant role in sport in America, myself excluded. Let me introduce my colleagues to my far right, Larry Doby, for Newark, raised in New Jersey, and then was the first black player in the American League, coming to baseball very shortly after Jackie Robinson, and is a historic figure for that reason, but is also one of the great players in baseball history and a member of the Hall of Fame because of his great skill of color. So I want to ask Larry to start by telling you a little bit about that first day in Chicago when Bill Veeck, a man I think is very underrated in this business, Ranch Rickey gets a lot of attention. Bill Veeck was a great man, and I'd ask Larry to speak about Bill Veeck bringing Larry to baseball and what it was like as a kid knowing that you're going to play in the big leagues as a young black ball player.
Well, first of all, I was very fortunate to have a gentleman like Bill Veeck to work for and work with. And one of the things that I remember very vividly is that when I went into his office, he had a notebook that stacked up that high. From the time that I was born until I got off the train in Chicago, July 5th, 1947. And there were a lot of things that we talked about. And one particular thing that stands out in my mind is he said to me that we're in this together. And at that time, of course, you young people don't realize, doesn't know, but there was segregation. And baseball had opened up for Afro-Americans. And we knew it wasn't going to be the easiest thing in the world to be involved in. But when you prepared for it, and when someone like Bill Veeck would make a statement to you that we're in this together, it sort of eased some of the pressure, if there's such a thing as pressure. My parents used to always tell me, if you're born with a dark skin, that's pressure. If you can handle it, then you're okay. But Mr. Veeck was a unique type of person. Respect for human beings. Respect for good people, respect for people, period. And I know that if I had had someone different than him, I might have been a little tougher for me to perform well and to perform under certain circumstances. But to have that kind of support along with your family and your friends, it made the job a little bit easier. And it's not like you're going into something that you don't know anything about. Number one, I always felt that I could play baseball. I was never doubt in my mind that I couldn't play baseball. The other thing is that when you had a person like Bill Veeck who thought about people as people, that eased a lot of the tension that might have been there in terms of not having him as sort of a backup type person to work with. He was a jazz lover, and he could sense when I had a bad day. He called me up, and he said, if I'm in Chicago, he called me up. He said, I'll see you tonight, or I'll see you tomorrow. And when he comes to Chicago or New York, wherever, first thing we do is go to listen to some jazz. George Sharon, Oscar Peterson, Count Basie, all those kinds of people. And I enjoy jazz. And it's kind of, you know, relaxing. And like music through the savage beast. And I think that's had a lot to do with my being able to be successful in baseball because of having that kind of support from him. I always try to think of being a part of baseball in the beginning and being neglected by some of my teammates was a misunderstanding as far as me as a human being is concerned, and not based on color. I'm not that naive that I know that some were based on color.
Larry, is it true that you went in the clubhouse and some of the guys wouldn't shake hands with you?
Yeah, I went to, after I left Mr. Vick's office in Chicago, I was taken to the ballpark by a fellow by the name of Lou Jones, who was the public relations man for Bill at that time. And matter of fact, his first wife was Lena Horn. So when he took me to the ballpark and went in the clubhouse, Boudreaux had all the players lined up by their lockers. And of course, Fay Vincent, Larry Doby, hand out shape. Joe Black, Larry Doby, no hand. So we went down the line, and quite a few hands did not come out to shake mine. That, you know, it's a funny feeling when you put your hand out and, oh, there's no hand, and didn't rub off, didn't come off, you know. So it's a little hard to digest that kind of a situation. The other part that was tough is when my locker was at the end of the clubhouse. And when I got dressed to go out on the field, I must have stood out on the field for about 5 minutes or more. It looked like 5 hours. But I had nobody to warm up with. So finally, a gentleman by the name of Joe Gordon, who I admire and I have great respect for, he warmed up with me, and we did it the whole year because nobody else would. But to be able to be in that position and to be able to sit here and talk to you about it, I don't want you to think, I'm not looking for sympathy or anything like that, and I don't want you to think that I'm bitter or I hate. I don't. That's not in my system to hate or to be bitter. I think if you hate and you're bitter, then you're confused. There's something wrong with you. You can't function. I think that Joe and Jack and Camp and Nuke and all of it, I think we'd hate or been bitter, we wouldn't have been able to perform. Because there were a lot of things that's happening to us that we could have become bitter or we could have hated. And I've always said that I've never been able to understand, not even today, why I'm disliked because my skin is dark. Or why do you dislike Jewish people? Or why do you dislike Italian people? Or why do you dislike Irish people? Or why do you dislike Polish people? I've never been able to understand why people come to that conclusion to dislike or hate people to that extent. I personally, from a color standpoint, I'm really dumbfounded because what did I do? All I ask for is the same opportunity any other person gets. I live in a democracy. There's justice for all, not for some. And I always say to myself, I try to live according to the teaching of the Bible. Now, I'm not saying I'm the greatest Christian in the world, but I do believe. And I've felt that God put us all on this earth as human beings, different colors, to see if we get along. We've proven that we can. But there's a reason for it. To be gifted with the ability that Slick and Joe and myself had is a gift from God above. There's no other way to think, as far as I'm concerned, but that way. I can read all the books in the world about how to play the game of baseball. If I don't have certain ability, I cannot play the game of baseball. I can give Einstein a baseball bat and a glove and a ball and say, go out there and play the game. He can give me a problem, work it out. It may take me 30 years. I might come close to working it out before you become close to being a baseball player. So there's a gift that I've gotten from God, and I've been fortunate enough to take advantage of it in 1947. And whatever the obstacles were, or whatever the negative was, you had to make them positive. And fortunate enough, those of us who got the early chance to play baseball made the negative positive, and that's why Joe and Slick and myself and the commissioners here now are talking about it. And I enjoy talking about it. I've never gotten to the point where if someone said to me, when you're sitting in the second base, the guys spit the bat views on you. Yeah, I don't mind talking about that. I'm not going to give the guy's name. But one of the things that I knew, and I was told, and I believed it when I was 22, 23 years old, and I'm 77 now, I don't believe it anymore, that if I started a fight, if I started in second grade, the guy spit tobacco on me, and I get up and start punching, the Afro-American people out of Sam would come down on the field. That is not true. Yeah, I don't believe that. But that was a way to get me out of the game. If I got up and started fighting with the guy in other words, if I wanted to defend myself, at that particular time, you couldn't do it. And I'm glad, because, sometimes, you have to kind of think about Dr. King, turn the other cheek. Not that easy, but in order for baseball and for myself to have been successful, that's what you had to do.
In August 1947, 4 months after Jackie Robinson had broken the National League color line, Larry Doby was signed for the Indians by Bill Veeck, who Larry Doby affectionately called as his godfather. And he was the first black ball player in the American League. He led the league in home runs in 1952 and 1954, led the league in RBIs in 1954, and was an all-star 6 times, 1949 through 1955. Subsequently became the Major League's second black manager in June of 1978 for the Chicago White Sox.
Back in the days when things were segregated everywhere, baseball was no different. Now maybe Cleveland's biggest impact on the game came when Bill Veeck brought Larry Doby here to play outfield in 47. Brooklyn in the National League had already signed Jackie Robinson, and Doby was the American League's first black player.
Hooray, hooray, the time has really come. Cleveland got Larry Doby, Brooklyn's got Jackie Robinson.
Doby was already quite a star in the Negro League, and he was one heck of a player here, too. He played 10 seasons for the Indians, he hit 215 home runs, and he played in 2 World Series.
Thank you. That's
second black manager in baseball, and I'm sure hoping to be the first. That relationship with Bill Veeck and the anticipation of the hiring from Montreal when you were coaching Montreal, and Cleveland wanted to have you back, and were you frustrated by that process where you came to Cleveland, acted as a coach, and things occurred where you just Frank Robinson
also like I would have loved to have been a part of Cleveland from a manager standpoint. Some people had the idea, and then others had other ideas.
Right.
And with Mr. Robinson coming there as a player manager, you're paying one salary for a person doing two things.
Right.
Mine would have been separate because I couldn't play anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that there was a money situation involved.
Right.
Plus, Mr. Robinson could still play.
Right.
And to be able to be a playing, see, Cleveland had been accustomed to a certain playing manager because Boudreaux was a playing manager when
sure.
I got there.
Sure.
So they kind of know, you know, the situation in terms of playing manager. And I would have liked to have been, you know, managing Cleveland.
Right.
You know, I got my start there and
sure.
nothing like sort of coming home and being a part of another part of baseball. But, I think you learn to deal with situations
mm-hmm.
that doesn't work out the way you think they should or the way you want them to. I went back to Montreal coaching.
Right.
And then Bill Veeck bought the White Sox in 59,
mm-hmm.
and went back to work for him. And I left baseball in 79. As coaching. I managed the White Sox in 78.
Right.
Then I got fired, and then I went back to coaching in 79. And then I decided, well, I'm going to go home.
Right.
So I went home and opened up a business, and I went to Japan in 62, played in Japan a year. And then I came back home, and Mr. Giamatti became the commissioner of baseball. And I got a call from him saying that, you know, would you like to be in baseball? I said, well, yeah, but I don't want to manage a coach anymore because I had enough.
Right.
So he decided that to work out of the front office. So I've been working out of the front office for the last 15 years or more.
Terrific.
And I enjoy it because I get an opportunity to visit a lot of schools, talk to kids about athletics and particularly about scholarships, baseball scholarships. And trying to give them some insight in terms of what it's all about as far as the big world is concerned.
Sure.
A little bit different being in a community and like the kids, college kids, you know, well, you're going to walk out into the world and you find it a little bit more difficult. And of course, you know, adjustment has to be made and you have to understand. And I think a little bit tougher now than it was maybe 25, 30 years
mm-hmm.
ago. Because it's all competitive, so competitive. And the emphasis now is on education. If you don't get a college education, you're not going to get a good job making good money. And even during my time, you know, my mom said, you'll get out of high school and get a job. So what's better than playing baseball making $400 or $500 a month? You can't beat that.
That's
you
know? Right, that's right.
But now it doesn't happen that way anymore, you know.
Veeck is in wreck, as he used to say. Bill bought the team from Alva Bradley in 46. I think it was about that time Bob Hope bought into the franchise, too. I don't know who was more showbiz, Hope or Veeck. In 47, Veeck moved his team to the stadium for good. He moved the fences in, too, so the players had a better shot at hitting a homer. And he looked for ways to lure crowds to the ballpark. He was a master promoter. He even got the ladies to come down to the games. He called it Ladies' Day.
He used to, under the seats over here, he used to have some kind of a card, maybe some monetary prize or some innovation that he had. He was always giving something away. Sometimes there were like stockings, hosiery, and there was various things, see, and you never knew because he had discriminately placed along these seats, and so all you had to do was come in there and lift up the seat and If you were lucky, you found one there.
I think Bill loved baseball, and he loved having fun, too. Like good old Joe Early Night. Now, that was something. It came about because Beck used to honor his players and name a day after them, like Lou Boudreau Day, and give them all kinds of gifts. Now, this guy, Joe Early, wrote a letter to the paper, and he said, "Hey, those players don't need all that stuff. What about the fans? Why not a good old Joe Early Night and give me the gifts?" That's just what Beck did, and he made it a big deal. He brought Joe and his wife, June, down on the field, and just for laughs, gave them a horse, a cow, and some goats. That really brought the house down. Then he gave Joe a truckload of really nice gifts, a washer and dryer, even a convertible car. Read that Joe passed away a couple of years back.
Is where Bill Beck attended school.
Really?
So
I didn't know that.
And as your desire and your you obviously expressed the fact of your deep feelings for Bill Beck.
Oh, yeah.
He started right here at Kenyon College.
I didn't know that.
So tonight you might want to work that in. You'll wow the crowd.
Yeah. I didn't know that. He turned out a great man, I'll tell you that. And particularly during that period of time. I don't think that my success would have been the same if I had somebody different than Bill Beck.
Mm-hmm.
I think Bill Beck added something to my life, and no question added something different than what you might think people were like at that time. You know, in other words, if you're being segregated against, then you put a lot of people into that category.
Mm-hmm.
But all of a sudden you find that he doesn't segregate you. And then all of a sudden now you realize the fact that certain people, not him. And you know, there was a restaurant in Miami that didn't allow Afro-Americans. So we were down there with my wife and my daughter, my oldest daughter,
mm-hmm.
and he was there. So he said, "We're going to this restaurant." Well, we had no idea that Afro-American didn't go there. We get out of the car, and my daughter was about maybe 6 or 7 years old,
mm-hmm.
and he puts her on his shoulder, and he walks right into the restaurant, and my wife and I are right behind him. And there's a table over there, and we sat at the table, and we ate, and we had a good time and all that. And after we left, the next day he said to me, he said, "You know what?" I said, "What?" "You're the first blacks ever ate in this restaurant."
That's terrific.
I said, "What?" I said, "Yeah." I said, "What are you trying to do, get me killed?" Yeah.
Now, your son played Larry Jr., didn't he? He played minor league baseball, didn't he?
Yeah, he graduated Duke.
Yeah.
And he played in Appleton, Wisconsin. He had a good year, 2 years in a row, and they didn't promote him, and he decided, "Well, you know, I got enough," and he left.
Did he ever play in the New York Penn League?
Yeah. I used to come up to see him play in, Niagara?
Niagara, right, Niagara Falls.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I'm from Jamestown, and Jamestown was in that league.
Yeah, right, yeah. Yeah, yeah, we used to drive up to see him play up there, yeah. He decided that he wasn't going to pursue it anymore, so he got involved in New York and New Jersey as a stagehand. So he works with Billy Joel and Springsteen and Elton John. Matter of fact, he's on the road now with Billy Joel. They're in, where is he now? I think he's in Nashville.
Well, that's a good name to be associated with.
Yeah, he makes a good buck.
Yeah.
Woo. Makes a good buck. I think one of the reasons why he left baseball was he had a friend that worked for the stage, was stagehand, and they were good friends in high school.
Right.
And he kept after him, "Why don't you come and give this a try?" And he said, "I'm going to give baseball another try." So then all of a sudden, when he had a good year in Appleton and they didn't promote him, he decided, "I'm going to leave." So he left and makes a good buck.
Did he feel the pressure of being a Larry Doby Jr.?
Yeah. I think all kids whose fathers are involved in any athletic endeavor, they expect their son to be as good or maybe better, you know, and not too many of them are. you know, unfortunately that kind of thing happened. But I think that if he wanted to spend more time, I think he'd have been a pretty good player. I don't know how good, but I think he'd have been a pretty good player. Mm-hmm. But you know, it's amazing how kids today, when you say I'm 23 or 24 years old, they say, hey, that's old. That's not old, are you kidding? You know, but it's amazing how they think,
yeah.
You know? And I've always said to him, I say, you know what? You know, you're not old until you get in the 50s. Then you begin to get old. But when you're in your 20s and 30s and even your 40s, you're not old.
Right.
You may not be able to play baseball for you, but then again, you look at some of these guys. Some of these guys are 41, 40, 38, 39 years old, and they're still playing. So when you talk about age, it's a different kind of thing altogether.
Were you there in Montreal when Dan Lanetta was the traveling secretary?
Yeah.
Danny's a real good friend of mine. Yeah. He's from Jamestown.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Danny, yeah. Danny, Jim Fanning. I can't think of the other fellow's name. John McHale was part owner.
Yep.
And that's who gave me the job in Montreal in 1969 when they selected the team, when they became the first expansion ball club. Yeah.
Do you get a sense if you'd have stayed in Montreal a little bit longer, you may have been the manager up there, or was the environment just not conducive to a black manager in Montreal?
I think it would have been.
Yeah.
I just think that there weren't too many Afro-American managers being hired at that particular time.
Mm-hmm.
But Montreal was a town that you didn't have segregation.
Right.
I mean, Mr. Robinson
started there, right.
And matter of fact, I would have started in Toronto because Cleveland AAA club was in Birmingham, Alabama.
That's right, yeah.
And they didn't have any integrated players at that particular time. So I was supposed to go to Toronto. Toronto was a AAA club to go. And when I went to spring training in 48, they put me in the outfield and I had a good spring and the rest of it became history.
Did you miss the fact you weren't an infielder anymore?
Yeah. I'd never played in the outfield before.
Yeah.
So I had a different, you know, I had to get accustomed to it. I've played infield all my life in all positions in the infield. And then I got to the big leagues, of course, and I had to adjust to playing the outfield. But it was, you know, after a while, it's like anything else. You learn to play it and have a certain amount of ability, and you're lucky enough to be able to be in that position.
In New Jersey, did you have a role model? You were playing baseball.
My role model was a kid out of high school. When I went to high school, there was a kid named Bob Smith who was an outstanding athlete, football, baseball, basketball. And all the coaches would talk about him. And I never seen him play, but they would tell you how great he was.
Yeah.
And that was sort of a model for me because you didn't have anybody in baseball that you could want to be like, you know. But then when you find that this kid had been that good at athlete in high school, you wanted to be that kind of a player.
As far as being in your community, the Joe Lewis's, the Jesse Owens, just people who of your race who have made it. I mean, who've made it.
They meant a lot to Afro-Americans and certainly to America when you talk about a Joe Lewis, heavyweight champion of the world.
Absolutely.
And then you talk about a Jesse Owens, who the conditions as far as segregation was concerned was still there, but when it came time for the Olympics, you wanted the best athlete, so that's the best athlete, so
yeah.
He's gonna be a part of it. Yet, when you came back home, you still had the problem of hotels and restaurants. But, you know, sometimes it make you a better athlete and make you a better person
mm-hmm.
to go through certain situations in your life that shouldn't be. An only man could put these kind of situations on you,
right.
And you're able to overcome it. You're able to be successful. Then it's got to be a good feeling under those circumstances
sure.
that you're successful.
You're over in Cleveland, 1947, obviously the first black man to break the American League, and Jackie is over in the National League. Did you guys communicate at all in 1947?
Yeah, we they used to allow us to play 30 games at the end of the season, barnstorming, they call it, in different cities.
Right.
And we did it for about 4 or 5 years. Socially, no, we never, I'm not going to say we were socially, but by playing these games, we got to know each other, travel together, and never got to the point where we discuss the bigotry or the segregation.
Yeah.
You know, because you get enough of that.
Right.
The only thing that we talked about is some of the people on other teams that were kind of nasty.
Yeah.
He knew the American League people, and I knew the National League people. And you know, at that time, there are a lot of people that we used to call them bench jockeys.
Mm-hmm.
You never played that much, but they're on the bench and, you know, they run their mouths and all that kind of stuff. But, you know, I never felt that I needed to discuss any of those type of things with him, because we're going through the same situation. And I don't want to hear it, and I know he didn't want to hear it, you know. You know, when you season is over, you're happy to get home and enjoy your family and enjoy the neighborhood and just have a relaxing good time without thinking about all the negatives that has happened or that going to happen and all the obstacles that you got to overcome.
Did you feel like every year you had to go back and prove yourself when you went to spring training? I know a lot of ball players have said that.
No, I never felt that way, but I know I had to.
Yeah.
You know, you 1 year, you can't live on 1 year. You know, you got to play good every year to be able to stay in that position and to be successful. And if you're playing good, then your team is going to be that much better.
Yeah.
But you kind of wanted to have a better year every year, you know, because you didn't get the big salaries then. You didn't get the big raise. You know, you'd have to have, if I hit 300 and drive in 100 runs and hit 30 home runs, I got to do the same thing the next year to get any kind of a raise.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes if you do the same thing, they keep you where you are or cut you. So you never wanted to be cut.
Right.
You always wanted to make a couple extra bucks. And you never got any big raises. You know, if you get a $6,000 raise, you're very lucky. You had to do a lot of good things to get that kind of money, you know. And they would always tell you that if you don't like this job, then find another one.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to find another job making $25,000 or $30,000 a year. Not during that time, you know. Some kids that went to college wasn't making that kind of money. And you're doing this in 6 months or so, you know.
Was there, was 1954 World Series, was that one of your bigger disappointments?
Oh, yeah, no question. Because there's no question in my mind that we had a good team. There's no question. And any time you can win 111 games out of 154, you had to have a good team.
You bet.
I think, I don't use this as an excuse, but I think that there was a great rivalry between New York and Cleveland. And New York had a record of 110 games. And the media and the people, they wanted us to break the record. We played up until that Sunday. Sunday was the last game, and we won 111 games on a Sunday. Monday, we were on a train to New York.
Right.
Tuesday, workout. Wednesday, start the season. I think that just a letdown. Boom. I'm not taking anything away from the Giants, and I'm not taking anything away from that club. They had a good club. We knew the club because we played against them in the spring.
Sure.
They're in Tucson. We're in Tucson, and they're in Phoenix.
Mm-hmm.
So we're playing an exhibition game again. And then during that time at the end of spring training, a week before the spring training is over, we come back together playing each other in different parts of the country.
Mm-hmm.
So they know our pitching staff and our hitters, and we know their pitching staff and their hitters. And I just think that motivation from a baseball player has to be made himself. I mean, it's not like football and basketball. You got five or six different coaches. You know, you got a football, you got a defense coach, an offense coach. You can get motivation out of that. In baseball, you got a third base coach, and a first base coach, and a pitching coach.
Right.
You know,
You didn't have hidden coaches at that time. You had hidden coaches now. You never had hidden coaches at that time. So the motivation had to come from the player. And I think we got to that point where we won the 111th game on a Sunday, and I think it was like, oh boy.
Yeah.
Now you're going to New York. And you're not ready. You're not ready for it. You're not ready to get yourself back to that level again, you know. And Dusty Rhodes, a couple of things that he did hurt us. You know, he hit the hit the home run to beat us in the 10th inning of the first game, and then the next day Willie makes his catch off of Vic Worth. Where
did you believe that catch?
No, I was on second base, and I never believed he'd make it. And then I knew he wasn't going to make it when I seen him turn his back and start running, and all of a sudden, Lee reached up and he makes the catch, the greatest catch I ever seen myself. And I say to him a lot of times, that's the greatest catch you've ever made. He said, nah, I made better ones, you know. But that
on. Well, things were quiet until 54. Now that year, our pitchers threw 78 complete games, and we were in the pennant race once again.
The World Series story of 1954 starts on this day of September 21, when 250,000 baseball fans welcome the Indians home after the pennant clincher in Detroit. This third Cleveland championship team won 111 games to set an American League record, ending the five-year world championship rule of the New York Yankees.
But the 54 World Series against the New York Giants was a giant disappointment. We lost the first two games in New York and the next two in Cleveland. Nobody could believe that our team, which was so good during the season, would lose four straight in the series. We didn't know then that would be the last series we'd ever watch on this field.
Made it a little bit tougher, because once you get two behind, it's not that easy. And then we go to Cleveland and we're three behind.
Yeah.
And you can't, you know, it's almost impossible. And Bob got beat. Dusty Rhodes hit the fly ball. As he'd been in Cleveland, it would have been caught by the second baseman,
yeah.
You know. And then Wynn got beat the next day, you know. So, and then you know, I didn't hit well. I had a terrible year. I think I hit like 216. The only guy on the ball club that hit pretty well was a guy by the name of Vic Worth and a guy by the name of Al Smith and another fellow by the name of Jim Hagan.
Mm-hmm.
The rest of us didn't hit the ball as well as we could have. And, you know, in a short series, you don't have that much time.
Later that evening, Larry Doby wowed a capacity crowd at Bolton Theater in Kenyon College, discussing the days of the segregation of baseball and the segregation of America. He truly was a leader. Noted columnist Claire Smith wrapped up the feeling of all the panelists who were at the event.
Lived in the American version of apartheid, as did their families, their parents, their mothers, their fathers, sisters, and brothers. My parents, my grandparents. It was an amazingly different country than the one that you enjoy like it now. Racism was not only a factor, it was an institution. It was enforced by the rule of law. And these gentlemen, when they put on a uniform and went in many, many states, they were literally breaking the law because Jim Crow was the rule of law in the South, in the southern states. They took their lives in their hands. They were threatened. They met the Klan up close and personal. They were stressed unbelievably by the razzing that went beyond just natural bench jockey. They led very lonely existences. They were propped up by their communities, by their churches, by their families, by their wives, and they had an amazing sense of self-confidence, an amazing patriotism for a country that treated them so badly, to be willing to pick up a gun and go to Guadalcanal and Iwo Jima. Slick was in both places, to fight in a war knowing that, in a sense, no one was fighting for their right to live, but they were fighting for Americans' right to live in a free country. to come back after the war and be denied jobs across the board, not just baseball, but in the factories. Slick was in an engineering corps, but that didn't mean that he could get a job doing what he did on an island under fire. So the tremendous passion that they had, not only for the game, but the country, is something that I will admire. And it predated these gentlemen. It's a baton, figuratively a baton, that African Americans watched Jack Johnson pass to Jesse Owens, Jesse Owens pass to Jackie Robinson, and Larry Doby. Let's not mistake the two. They came into baseball together. The Negro Leaguers held that baton for Jackie and Larry, and they passed it to Joe, to Billy Williams, who was the first African American to play Major League Baseball without having gone through the Negro Leagues. It's a time continuum of great pride and passion for the game and for the country. There is no bitterness, and that amazes me, and it's why I have a hard time listening to the bitterness and the silliness of athletes who today feel disrespected because they don't make $15 million and talk about their trials and tribulations as a driftwood platinum and things like that. It's hard to deal with this generation of privilege and know this generation of true strength and honor. So I feel privileged just to be here. I'm going to stop talking so they can continue to talk.
The lady who just spoke at the Kenyon convocation was Clara Smith. A little more than 2 years after this concluding remarks, she announced in the New York Times the passing of Larry Doby, who broke the color barrier in the American League.